We're back!
Woo!
Great to see you, Tyler, even though it's still virtual.
I look forward to us pushing these boxes a little closer.
It is season two of the Live and Original Spotlight. Thank you to the town of Collingwood and 95.1 The Peak FM. We're back to once again celebrate and promote our local music industry.
Yeah, I mean, it, you know, the world is coming back. We've got patios open. People are going out. Artists are playing. You had a busy weekend.
Yeah, you know what? The patio shows are opening up. That's, you know, a good sign. Looks like things are starting to happen. We're going to talk a bit about that with some of the artists that we're going to be speaking with. We've got Melanie Case from 95.1 The Peak FM coming up with a club and concert information. She's going to be joining us each month with it. Hopefully, as the months go on, there'll be more to talk about. But there's still quite a lot happening. We're also going to check in with Route 26. Laura Koenig is going to join us.
Yeah, honestly, it's great to see. Actually, I don't want to give it away what Laura's talking about. But when we get there, I think some artists will be very excited to see new opportunities.
We also are going to check in with our industry specialist, Nathan Ferraro. Many of people, certainly Collingwood folks, are going to remember him as a founding member of the Midway State, two-time Juno-nominated songwriter. Unbelievable. Interesting career path for him, and we talked to a great deal about that. That's coming up as well. But we start off our segment the way we started off season one, in a way.
Yeah. We, you know what? I'm hoping not too much like season one. We had some technical issues, so it's a little tongue in cheek that we played the machine right at the opening. Craig Smith has volunteered to be our guinea pig twice now, and I want to assure him that we will definitely not lose his audio. So,
yeah. Well. Craig, a lot has happened to Craig even in the midst of the pandemic.
Yeah.
Of course, a very popular local singer, songwriter, producer, Craig Smith. He went into the studio virtually with Frank Deresti and the other members of a band that they formed called Ontarians. They released an album just recently called The Greatest Short Story Never Told. We got a chance to sit down and talk to Frank Deresti and Craig Smith about Ontarians.
Photographs and epitaphs are remaining. I'm yours.
And that's a little tiny bit of Ontarians. Really proud to have them as our very first in season two of Spotlight as our featured artists. We had a great time with Craig last season.
Feels like yesterday.
It does feel like yesterday, Craig. Welcome back. And a welcome to Frank Deresti. Frank, a pleasure to talk to you. It's been a very long time since I've seen you. You're, of course, in Sault Ste. Marie up in the Sioux.
That's
but
right.
You're no stranger to this area. Of course, folks will remember the Lake Effect performing here many, many times. Great to have you joining us on this project as well.
I'm working. My goal is to become an honorary citizen of the Collingwood area. So,
well, Frank, you're well on your way. You're very well on your way. Now, some will say in this community that unless your grandmother was born here, you're not really a local. But you're well on your way. I you know what? I know you're a collaborative team, but credit where credit's due. Who came up with Ontarians as the name for the band?
Well, that would be Mr. Franklin Deresti. Frank Deresti came up with that name. And I got to be honest, I wasn't sold on the name. It was kind of like, he was talking to me while I was doing something. It kind of hit me in the shoulder, and I'm like, we'll put that one in the bank.
What made you come up with that one, Frank?
I don't know. I think I just, I don't remember, like, you know, there was no great epiphany or anything like that. I think I was just batting around names, as you do when you realize that you're going to have one at some point. And I like the ring of it. It's something that we all have in common. And I think it sounds all right. I hadn't considered things like search engine optimization when the name came up. So we'll keep working on that. But
if I tried to find your album, I accidentally signed up for a fishing license.
Right. That's exactly it, John. That's why our merch is all going to be, I think, because we're just working on concept, but very, Ontario fishing, you know, camping, like that sort of vibe, because I think we have that kind of in spades.
Yeah. Now let's talk about Geography, a band called Ontarians. You have, I mean, all from Ontario, but you've got Jay down there in Texas. Your drummer's, I think he's in the Sioux as well.
Yeah,
you know, you're in the Sioux. Craig's still here. Doesn't that make that geographically difficult to be a band? Or has technology changed that?
Well, John, you are a bright man, and yes, it does make it very difficult. in fact, Ontarians is, yeah, we're an unproven band as far as we're concerned. We've never played a live show together. You know,
this could all be hype. Let's be honest about this.
It's some hype. In a normal world, we'd be out touring. We probably have done our first tour by now, because the record came out in mid-March. So we're kind of chomping at the bit to get out there and prove ourselves as a live band. This whole pandemic has made us all adapt and just kind of, you know, set our sights on whatever happens, with the intent that we're going to go out and play shows. And we've got a new record in the works already, and we're really looking forward to what's ahead.
Frank, you guys have been asked this 1,000 times, but I have to ask it. Both you and Craig and the other guys in the band had music careers outside of this and still do. What brought you together to do this in the middle of a global pandemic?
Well, we started doing this before the pandemic, before we had even heard of we didn't even know that there was a pandemic in the works.
Had we only known at the time.
We may have worked quicker. Craig and I met on the road playing in different acts, probably a decade or so ago, in a couple of different times, and sort of became friends and fans of each other's work. And there was always this sort of ongoing casual conversation, like one day we'll do something together. And then we got together and started writing songs together back in 2018. And that was sort of the genesis of this project. And so we were, when the pandemic hit, we were basically just kind of wrapping everything up for this first record.
Before we get into the new record and the Ontarians and what the future holds, let's talk a little bit about the past, just to give us a bit of perspective, maybe a little bit of remembering of what we've heard from you guys. Frank, you had the Lake Effect for many years.
I'm gonna get it done, yeah, this time.
Is that still an ongoing band? Do you still work with many of those guys?
Oh yeah, for sure. Within and without the Lake Effect, I'm still involved with all of those guys in a bunch of different capacities musically, for sure.
Usually when they put someone's name in front of the band, it means that that person's probably pulling the strings or making the calls. Is it different when you're part of a more of a collaborative thing? I mean, although not to say that Lake Effect wasn't collaborative, but your name's not in front. You're kind of one of the guys.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. That was a very deliberate decision by Craig and I early on, that this was to be a collaborative project. And like you said, yeah, you know, all bands are collaborative projects, but the Lake Effect was something that I started, I had an idea of, and then got the players to do. And I was the sole songwriter for that project. And it was a completely different thing. Whereas Craig and I just started from zero with this project and built it into something that we both wanted to do. And so it was right from the start, the whole idea was this is a collaboration. And let's see where it goes.
Craig, you know, listening to some of your albums, like Heavy Early, you know, you have a bit more of an edge, a bit more of a rock feel than Ontarians.
Slowly on our way, so I propose that we raise a toast to the devil and the Holy Ghost.
What really sparked you to want to work with Frank and be part of this project?
Well, that's a great question. As part of my journey, I've become a rapper as well. So, I mean,
I do not look surprised.
I'm semi-serious. I mean, I did like a rap sort of record, and it's just all, it was part of the journey. Working with Frank has kind of been a bit of a, it's been a, like Frank said, you know, we met at least a decade ago and had an instant chemistry. So Ontarians was like, well, I think I have an idea of how this could sound. And I think if I just kind of, you know, let myself fall into the process of working with Frank, it's just going to happen on its own. And that's exactly what happened. It was a really easy chemistry that we have. And that made it really cool to write a record with him.
More of the Ontarians coming up. Actually, Ontarians, not the Ontarians, Ontarians. More coming up later in the show. Thank you for joining us here on Spotlight, looking at the live and original music scene in and around the Collingwood area. Next up, we're going to chat with our industry guest. And today, we had such a great connection with Nathan Ferraro. Now, I met him when he was literally a child. He was a teenager in school here. We talk a bit about that. He's gone on to be a prolific and very successful songwriter, producer, working with some very famous names in the Canadian music industry. But we remember the days when he was in Midway State. We start off our conversation talking a little bit about the rather quick rise and success of this rather extraordinary band. Talk again to my friend Nathan Ferraro, who I have not seen his face in so very long. Nathan, great to have you here on Spotlight.
Thank you, John.
It has been so long, we have a ton of catching up to do.
Yeah.
So I actually want to start from right at the very beginning when I met you. You and your buddy Danon,
yes,
were going to Jean Vanier Catholic High School at the time.
Yes.
Came into the radio station because we were doing our independent Spotlight, just like local, live and original.
Yep.
And you brought me a CD and on it was written Midway State. Where was your headspace for you two guys at that point?
Excited. Like I think, like I was saying just before we started recording here, like I was just always so into the recording studio and the drama department at school, or the PA, like literally not just being on the PA announcements, but the actual PA speaker system. And and I just liked it. So, and Danon was the same. And we instantly nerded out and connected on that stuff. So we would have been in your studio in the office, just so happy that we were missing calculus and we were there at the Peak FM on the radio. Like what a thrill.
What shocked me is that from the time we first played that song, and we were the first radio station in Canada to play Midway State.
Yes. Yes.
From that moment to hearing about the fact that you're nominated not one, but two Juno Awards, that seems so lightning fast. How did that happen?
It was so interesting. So when we first met you, we probably had just started the band in maybe grade 10 or 11. And so from, you know, it probably was about 3 years or 4 years, but in high school, we were playing tons of shows. And, you know, we didn't know that we were developing as a band. We were just doing it because we loved it. We loved hanging out. And it was sort of there were goalposts, or we wanted to be accepted into this show. You know, we wanted to play with this band in Aurelia. And if we could do that, that would be really cool. So we spent like those 2 years in high school. And then the year after high school, really with our heads down, focusing on this band. And it just came so naturally to us.
How important do you think it was to your success, or at least getting you started into the business, that you and Danon both said, we're graduating high school, this is what we're doing now? You didn't necessarily have a plan B. You know, you weren't working on it while you were studying something else.
No.
This is the deal. First of all, how did you get your parents to agree to that?
Yeah.
And second, how frightening was it, or was the passion there so much it didn't matter?
Yeah, I think that, like, I mean, there's probably, we were young too at the time, you know, 18 years old. So in a way, it's like we could have messed up like four times and still been like 22 years old. Like, your life's not over, even though like you might think so. But so we definitely started young, where it definitely didn't feel like scary, you know, or like we were throwing something else away. Like I was like, we were like, go to college, like, sure. But there was nothing that was really like we were turning down. It's not like, you know, either of us wanted to be a specific thing. Right. We just loved the music. And in terms of our parents, again, I don't think we were really asking we're kind of like, this is what we're doing, these, you know, and there was always sort of like a, it's like, hey, John Eaton just like invited us to come on the radio, you know, and they think the song's really good, and they just played our song. And our parents were always like close to us as friends in a way, so they were sort of along for the ride too, you know. But it never got real.
You have
real.
A very big family of creative people.
Yes, I do. Exactly. Like my sister Claudia right now is
poet laureate. Thank you.
Poet laureate.
Much.
Exactly. Exactly. Which I learned what that was when she got the position. And she might have too, but she's, I love her writing. My brother Dominic, what a writer, what a musician, like Christian. Just Christian, like just on and on, you know, everybody. Lucy's, she's getting her architecture degree right now. Her design and stuff is so cool. Oh. It's nice to have the support around for sure.
So you certainly had that nurturing, and you had a bit of a emotional safety net as you took off, loaded up the van and headed to Toronto and let's go make it.
Yeah, absolutely. Never felt like you better make it or else you've made the wrong decision, you know?
Right. You go into the studio with some high level producers and
yes.
And you know, this is the real deal. Was that a nerve wracking experience, or was it, this is what we dreamed of, let's have fun?
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. You get very close to the people in the studio you're with, the producers. It's kind of like we'd be like being on a hockey team, you know? And the producer we were with, Gavin Brown, he'd be like, all right, boys, this is the NHL now. Like, this isn't Pee Wee anymore. This is the NHL. Everything is serious. Everything is, you know? And turns out it was a blast. But I remember definitely being very intimidated, like making our first record in a big studio where you're spending hundreds of thousands of dollars. It kind of like, it's hard to like trust your own instincts or think, let's do this or let's do this.
Easy to second guess.
Absolutely. And it's changed a little bit in the industry to nowadays where there's so much ability now to record in smaller studios, in home studios. It's just different. You don't have to spend $1,000 a day on the room. So while sometimes like, yeah, it's intimidating and it's nice to just be able to record out of your home, there is also something I'll say that came as a young person being put in that position. It's like, all right, now or never, you know, the recording button's on, like, let's go. And that's a pretty cool feeling as well.
The album comes out and boom. I mean, people are talking about it instantly, it seemed. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, come around Juno time, 2 nominations. Your song is picked up nationally across Canada as a ringtone. I mean if nothing else, exactly. In that age made you think you made it, you must have. Yeah, we're kind of a big deal.
Exactly. There were certainly moments I remember, you know, so we're still in our early 20s then or really early 20s, and we won the much music video award, and you know, you're getting called on stage and having these VJs you've known as a kid hand you the award and talk to you. I was so excited, like, I couldn't be cool. It was like, I like, you learn that later too. You're like, oh, the real, like, the next level is like being cool about this. So I was like, I remember I went onto the stage for the Much Music Video Awards and there was probably the whole band, and I, Leia, the host, is holding the award and interviewing me, and she passes me the mic. And I just grabbed the mic right out of her hand and start talking, and watching it back, I was like, wow, that was like an aggressive, just let's grab the mic. I got this. It's my moment.
See, that's where Kanye got the move from.
Exactly.
You go in to make the next album, Atlantic.
Yes.
What was that like? What was that experience?
So things get a little less... things get a little more melancholy, a little more real, a little more real life. It's like we're flying on cloud 9. We put out the first record. It's all over the radio. We win the Much Music Video Awards at Junos. the American company Interscope doesn't pick up the option to do another record, because you learn, it's like, yeah, you're good, but there's lots of really great people as well that Jimmy Iovine is signing, and you know, it's business. They're going to put the money where the virality is happening, or where the American radio is happening. So anyways, we still it's like, okay, no worries, you guys don't believe in it, we still believe in ourselves.
Did you have that same resolve then as you do now? You know, there's certainly no bitterness. I don't hear any bitterness. I don't hear any anguish. At the time, was it emotionally hard to deal with?
Absolutely, hugely. Yeah. It's like it definitely rocked my world. You know, it's kind of like it feels like, you know, these were promises. I'm going to help you be Bruce Springsteen. And 24 months later, I'm sitting there like, what was all this Bruce Springsteen talk? But yeah, as a young person that had just been sort of lifted up, all of a sudden it's just like, woo, and it's all gone. And you're like, it was very hard to reconcile, very hard to understand. At that point, it's nice to be in a band because
you've got other guys going through it.
You got your friends. Yeah. You're not totally on an island.
Right.
And I think that's what allowed us to, we focused on Canada. We had great management and record label in Canada that we took on. And we were kind of like, you know what, we're going to make a second record and it's going to be even better. And we're going to try really hard. And so we spent the next couple of years making Atlantic and that record, and then touring that record as well.
Wow. So that's just part one of a very extensive interview with Nathan Ferraro, and I dare anybody at home not to immediately fall in love with him. Just an amazing start, and really where we're going to go in Nathan's story is kind of where he resides now, working with artists from Lady Gaga to Bulow and more. I mean, if you haven't already noticed, we have little Spotify tags that come up on the screen, and you can scan and take a look. If you do have a Spotify account, take a look at Nathan's page on there. He has a complete listing of some of his tracks. But we'll have more on Nathan a little later. We're actually going to go to Route 26 now with Laura Conning. And as I kind of teed up at the start, artists, pay attention. There's something exciting going on with Route 26.
Conning is with Route 26, route26.ca, a great magazine of sorts online, and you are doing a number of profiles of artists, not unlike our show here, but we're going to check in with you each month because we want to find out what are some of the hot things to look for on the internet for local music.
Yeah, great. Well, thank you so much, first of all, for having me. It's really fun to be involved like this, and yeah, I love the talk of the town and these spotlights as well. Yes. So first of all, everyone can check out our Instagram at Route 26 Ontario, where we post about articles that we've just published or things that are going on in the local music scene. We've just published an article with our Collingwood poet laureate, Claudia Ferraro, who's just this incredible, inspiring woman. I think everyone should read that article just to see what she had to say. And there's some new artists popping up in the area. There's actually one that I don't think we've talked about before, and it's these two women. It's actually two women who I went to high school with, so I have this like personal connection with them. The one is Sarah May, who's the front woman of a band called Falcon Jane. They play in this area a lot, so people might be familiar with that name. And she's paired up with another great, sorry, my dog's here. She's paired up with another great female singer-songwriter, Erin Bolton. And they're both such powerhouse songwriters that when I saw that they came together and formed this new band, I'm so excited about it. They've just posted some little teasers on their Instagram and stuff that people can check out and then stay tuned for what's to come when they release some music. So their new band is called Super Crescent.
Super Crescent. Looking for that on the internet.
Looking for that. Absolutely. And then one other thing I wanted to mention while I'm here is that Route 26 is putting together a jamming database for local musicians. So I've had some people reach out, especially through COVID, where people are, you know, looking to get a little more creative. Maybe they have a little more time, or they're fresh faced to Collingwood and looking to meet some people. And they're looking for people to jam with and just to get connected with some local musicians. So if you go to our Instagram or to our Facebook page, which is the same name, Route 26 Ontario, you'll see the details. Basically, I'm just asking for people to email me or DM me with some of their contact details, a little bit about what kind of music they like to play, and any social media links. And then what we're going to do is set up a password protected page where all of the respondents will be listed so that people can go in there and kind of browse through and go, oh, this person looks like a good fit. And then you already know, yeah, they want someone to jam with too. So then you can go ahead and connect with them and get to work.
It sounds like it a great fun idea, especially as things start to open up. We're going to want to get together and play, and what better way to make some new musical friends?
I'm so excited. I'm hoping that at some point this summer, maybe in the fall, we can do a big outdoors thing too. Just kind of casually invite people down to the Arboretum or something to do a little meet and greet in person. We're not quite there yet, but hopefully soon. So, yeah.
Well, Laura, we'll check in with you next month. In the meantime, we'll be checking out route26.ca. Oh, that's awesome. What a great idea, getting musicians together to just jam.
I know. I was thinking so much about our Music Lab Mondays that we used to have, and it was always so amazing to see artists come together and just, you know, get into a big collab on this stage that I've just essentially been living on this whole pandemic. So to see something like this and to hear Laura say, you know, maybe people coming together, a barbecue. Does that not sound like the coolest barbecue you could probably just go to?
Sounds like the future.
Right? I want it. I want it now.
The one thing, you know, we certainly talk about how much musicians have been missing getting together and performing. And but you know what? We often forget to talk about the fans and how much the fans of live music, the supporters of local live music, have not had, you know, our local live lunch to see, or the Canada Day concerts, or any of that kind of stuff. Yeah. And we thought, you know what we should do maybe each month is check in with a local music connoisseur, a fan that you, one of those people that you see show up and support live music in our community all the time. And we thought that one of the best guys to start with would be, of course, Mr. George Czerny. Live and Original Spotlight comes to you from Simcoe Street Theater, well, at least in a perfect world. COVID-19, not so much. But we are very happy to have a gentleman who has intimate knowledge of this building. He spent many years here. He's also going to talk to us about the local music scene that he's a big supporter of. It's my pleasure to welcome my friend George Czerny.
Well, thank you very much. And I have to give you full disclosure, because I'm the guy that, when I was a kid, I had a crystal radio, and I was so naive. I thought all those musicians coming in to perform at the station were really there.
Now, we talked about your connection to Simcoe Street Theater. That's because going way back, you were a newspaper man.
Yes, and then I came to Collingwood in 1977 when Collingwood didn't have to offer musicians the kind of things it has to offer today. And we were in a crummy old building at 27 Simcoe Street, and eventually the Enterprise Bulletin newspaper became popular enough that we could afford to build a new building, which we did at the corner of Simcoe and St. Marie Streets, which is owned by musicians, music patrons and theater patrons, Annika and Richard Lex. They bought the old Enterprise Bulletin building, which to me in the winter of 88, 89 was the new Enterprise Bulletin building, and where Simcoe Street Theater is, used to be the press room and the mail room.
Absolutely. I remember those days. Most recently, I bump into quite often, well, back when we were allowed to go to concerts, we would bump into each other at so many of the concerts. So I've asked you to kind of come on the show today just to sort of talk about what we've been investigating with each episode of Spotlight, is how amazing and unique our music community is, certainly in terms of the quality and the quantity of music that gets produced and performed here. Has it always been that way? You've spent some time in this town. When did you see that start to build?
Well, thanks to the town of Collingwood and having the foresight to start supporting local music events in concert with sponsors like the Peak or Collingwood Hyundai, or the town of Collingwood has broadened its horizons, and music is a big part of tourism. And it wasn't always so. Back in the 70s when I came here, we had the Blue Mountain Foundation for the Arts, and they had a children's programming component. They brought Sharon and Lois and Brown to town. Now, this is for people to watch in a pay-for venue.
Right.
Then we had the Chamber of Commerce was very active, and we had an incredible thing called Summerfest downtown. Wall-to-wall people, musicians playing. It was a hoot. It was also very dangerous because there were no fire lanes, but we won't talk about that. Also, the Chamber of Commerce had bluegrass up on the slopes of Blue Mountain, where the Blue Mountain Foundation for the Arts, which was spearheaded by the late Barbara Wider, they had a concert shell there. And it was a beautiful venue for the Good Brothers and that. But then things started to really change and focus, especially in recent years, when local musicians started to get credit, if you can think of it that way. And they were invited to come to things like local live lunch downtown Collingwood in front of the Sheffer building. Fantastic. Other musicians went to, thanks to Frank McNulty and his bunch, over to the jazz thing at the museum. But way, way back when I first came to town, most of the music was hidden away. And Stephen Charles, for example, back in the 70s, played at the Highwayman Inn. He's still around town, but he used to be an entertainer who lent as a volunteer, much like some of you guys do, lent as volunteers their support to local endeavors. And but most of the stuff was happening in the hotels and happening in hidden sort of venues. Now we have a local live lunch. We have the jazz thing that used to be, and I hope it comes back. We have backyard concerts. I'd never been to one until Aaron Garner, who's a local musician, invited me to one. And I can't remember the guy's full name, but he was fantastic. His name was Taylor. And he was from Toronto and he performed here. And he was an inspiration to local musicians, as well as entertaining people like me.
You are very good on social media of promoting and capturing great images of some of our local artists. And importantly, some of the burgeoning artists who, you know, wouldn't maybe have the cash to come up with hiring a photographer and getting those magic shots. You take them and willing them, give them to the artists.
I do gift them to the artists. And I'm a retired old guy. And it's the least I can do. But the least people can do is support local artists, whether they're painters, Dave Saunders painting, for example, or musicians. And we have so many different kinds of musicians. And we're blessed. We're truly blessed in Collingwood with so many different kinds of musicians. I'll give you a little rundown if I have time.
Yeah.
Keiko Yoden came to Collingwood from Japan, a concert pianist and also a downhill skier. And Keiko is a wonderful concert pianist, remarkable talent. She married Dennis Kupfer, and she's now Keiko Yoden Kupfer, but she's a musical talent. And I've heard her not only at All Saints Anglican Church, where she's the music director, but also on the street pianos that Jim Kinnear put out, playing the ivories and playing with Susan Connolly, who plays the violin. We have another concert pianist in town, and he just loves Collingwood. He lives in Vienna, but he loves Collingwood, and he's been running music festivals here, and he's got one online just blooming as we speak. His name is Daniel Vunikovsky. Daniel's last name is as challenging as my last name, but Daniel's such a musical talent, a concert pianist who plays in venues like San Francisco and concert halls all around the world, and he loves Collingwood and spends his summer here bringing music to Collingwood people. And then you can go to off the charts to local musicians, you know, the Drew Wrights and the Mike McCarthy bands and the Austin McCarthy, and I could go on and on with a few names, but I don't want to hog the show.
No, this is what you, this is why you're here, George. Let's talk about you. You're talking about bands. What are some of your favorites? Do you have any favorites? Are there any that you go, your lovely wife, Nancy, you know, we can't miss this one. We got to go.
The one we can't miss, and we heard at the Simcoe Street Theater in Collingwood, and I think all of Canada deserves to hear this group. And you're going to blush, John, because you're in it. It's called the Shipyard Kitchen Party. And you have Sasha Law and Jason Murphy.
Yeah.
And Jason Murphy plays that handheld drum from Newfoundland.
The bar on.
And Sasha, you know, when she sings, you have to hide the champagne glasses if you want to keep them. But she's fantastic. And I mean that as a compliment to that group. The Shipyard Kitchen Party is one of my favorites. And then I just marvel at people like Austin McCarthy, a young guy. You know, people think of musicians, perhaps they think that, oh, they don't have other talents. But Austin McCarthy, it was going to school, the university for business. He's got a great head on his shoulders, but he can play a wicked guitar. And his dad, Mike, when he's playing with that cowboy hat on, he just engages his audience as much as Garth Brooks does.
And I think of Mike kind of like a musical superhero.
Absolutely.
You know, you see him on the street. He's a gentleman, a businessman.
Absolutely.
Put on the hat, and next thing you know, he's a rock star.
Absolutely.
And he also puts together a great band. He always seems to have the best players in town surrounding him, which is a smart move to do, I think.
I don't know all the people by name, but if it was happening down at local live lunch, I'd be there. And local live lunches where you meet new talents, up and coming talents. And I don't have all the names, unfortunately, so I mean no disrespect, but there's one young lady that I saw. She's a product of Collingwood Collegiate Institute, and her name is Renee. And I heard her at the local live lunch playing with two other students. She was the vocalist, and they were performing, and they just blew everybody's socks off. And Collingwood,
yeah, that's something to make note of. You know, CCI especially is really noted for their outstanding music program, award-winning music program.
Absolutely. Thanks to Kevin Hamlin for that, for bringing them
started
along.
Started that up, yeah.
Wonderful guy, wonderful music. We used to go until the pandemic hit, we used to support them as much as possible. Mm-hmm. And that's the thing about music. It's an international language. You know, you hold from the local live lunch downtown Collingwood to some resort in Cuba, or from the amphitheater over to some island in Greece where there's music at a restaurant. You don't have people fighting. They don't fight to the strains of Imagine by the Beatles. Music is an international language, and people just sit back and enjoy it and love it.
And it's also a great way to bring a community together, like you mentioned with local live lunch. What are some of the other venues that you enjoy catching live music at?
The paid for ones were places like the Huron House.
Right.
And I can remember throwing a curve. I don't know all the titles of songs. I'm not a musician. I have the things in my head about music, but that I love. But Jason Redmond was performing at the Huron Club, and I asked him, because it was request time, to play that song called Hallelujah by Leonard Cohen. And I thought, you know, that's a tough one. I think it is anyway. And he sang it flawlessly. Remarkable guy. And you have other musicians like Rick Garner can spring over from playing a lead guitar to a bass guitar and
piano.
A wonderful gentleman. Rick Garner is a nice guy. Jim Kinnear, you know, organizing music and getting involved with street pianos and with the Great Northern Exhibition the Great Northern Exhibition, which used to be right here in Collingwood until they expanded into Clearview Township on their own property, has a wonderful music program, and Jim and his wife Felicity were involved with that.
I've always enjoyed the songwriter's tent over at the Genie.
That's right. Samantha Jones was a major force on organizing the songwriter stage at the GNE and bringing along musical talent. People shouldn't be shy about getting involved in music and approaching Tyler at the town of Collingwood, or approaching you at the radio station and asking, how do I do this? How do I do that? Or going downtown to the music store and getting some direction. People should not be bashful. You know what? Musicians are musicians. And I always say that musicians, they may be terrific musicians, but they may not be the best of accountants. They may not be the best promoters in terms of marketing. So we have to encourage them to get out there and do some promoting by talking to people.
Truer words were never spoken, George Czerny. George, what a pleasure of this chance to chat with you. Thank you so much for sharing some of your memories and some of the great stories that you have. And we're going to keep looking for more and more of them on your Facebook page and check your socials as you continue to cover so very well all the great musicians and performers in our community.
John and Tyler, don't forget to go to the Collingwood Library. They have a music program at lunchtimes there featuring new talent. Don't forget to go there and enjoy it.
Great idea. George, thank you so much.
Just before you go.
Yep.
You're on there.
Wow. Well, that was George Czerny just kind of going over a bit of Collingwood's history, the tourism, the music scene. There's so much, and it's very clear, you know, that excitement can't really be contained in George, but, you know, we're all looking for George at our next event, you know, all that energy coming out. So if you are somewhere and you see him there with the camera, like he says, don't be afraid, you know, say hi, smile, get in a photo. Up next, actually, we're going to be returning to part two with Nathan Ferraro. And this segment actually kind of goes over where Nathan resides now in the writer producer kind of credit. So without further ado, we'll jump into that.
The transition from Midway State after that second album. What was your headspace? How do you get from there to being, you know, you and Mike Wise being the guys that people now call on to make their other people stars? How did you make that transition?
Yeah, it's interesting. A lot of people ask, I want to be a songwriter or I want to be a producer. How do I do that? And it's, again, just by doing it. Me and Mike had experience in the studio because of Midway State. So when we were finally had enough of touring and that came to an end, it was like really natural to sort of keep going to the studio. Mike worked with Togs, who's like a famous Canadian producer songwriter that had worked on some songs with our band. Mike became his right hand guy and learned tons of stuff. And I got a call from a label called Wax Records. And they said, kid, would you want to write a song, you know, or write some songs for some of our artists? And I probably spent a year saying no. I was pretty hesitant. And eventually...
Is that because you're thinking, well, there's still going to be another Nathan Ferrar album, or there's going to be another Midway State album, and I need those songs.
Exactly. I was like, I'm not giving you my songs, no way. And then it was just, like a lot of things in life, it's just happenstance. It's like, eventually, this label convinced me to come up. They signed a guy that was a friend of a friend, Virginia DeVegas, who's a friend of my brother Christian's. And so I was like, well, I can't say no to Derek. So me and Derek started hanging out and writing songs. And one day we'd been writing for months, like with a team of people up there, they were really trying to find songs. I'd probably spent 5 days or more with them. And then I remember I was driving up in my car and it was like, there were some big producers in from LA, and I was like, okay, the pressure's on. Like I need to deliver something today. And I remember writing "We Are Stars," this kind of melody in the car on the way up, just hearing it and singing it. And I showed up at the studio that day. It's probably eight people and producers in the room, and I really like shyly sang the chorus. I was like, "What about this?" And I sang it. And it was one of those moments where everyone was just like, "Yes, yes, yes," and the producer sort of jumped on board. And within a couple of days, the track was finished and the label was like, we're going to the radio. And then it got picked up on the radio it was a big hit on Canadian radio. So I kind of fell backwards into that one. And then, but that was the first time that I ever saw like, I'm getting checks from this. This is another way for me to be in music and use my talents and continue to make a living.
You also got to perform, or at least record and do a video with Lady Gaga.
Yes, indeed. So cool. We had mutual A&R kind of contacts, and the timing worked out where she wanted to do something with the band. And, you know, she was still rising at the time. But, yeah, ended up spending a bunch of time with her. And I got to really see a vision into her, like, creative process, and just a so serious and real and professional. Like, it was a great, like, learning kind of experience for me, for sure.
You've also connected on a number of really hit songs with Bulow.
Yes. Yeah, Bulow's been just a joy for the last few years for me and for my friend Mike Wise, and one of my other best friends, David, now through the Bulow Project, and another friend, Lowell. We met her through Wax Records, this record label that signed her when she was probably 16 years old. And it was just a very interesting thing. You work with a lot of people, but with her, with Mike Wise and myself, and it just kind of, all the stars aligned. And one of the first days we were together, we wrote Not a Love Song with a group of people. Yeah.
And that's a good start, isn't it?
Yeah, right? So, and it's funny how it works. We wrote that song and it probably sat on a hard drive for 6 months, I think, until it was someone that worked at the record label, not in one of the in charge positions, but he said to the owner of the label, hey, this song, like, that's in the Dropbox link, or this artist, this song is amazing. And so the senior people listened to it again and it ended up becoming a single, and then it was an immediate hit.
And then Bulow was a star.
A star, you know, and it, the first time that me and Mike had top 40 American radio success, you know, and that it just a whole nother level than we'd really experienced. And so that was, yeah, it's been so fun. And then just working with Megan Bulow, it's a very natural process. And like, I just love her voice and I love her intuition and her vision of things. So it's kind of like, it's a lot of fun, you know, it never feels like work. It always just feels like what can we do today that's like so different and so fun. And yeah, I don't know. It's lucky when you come across artists where it just kind of fits like that.
So the way the business works is you're now dividing that songwriting royalty, right?
Yes. Yes.
So, and how do you make it lucrative? Do you have to be top 40 in the US to make it pay?
Kind of.
Yeah.
There's nothing like commercial radio, American commercial radio, worldwide commercial radio, your Dua Lipa, you know, you want to write a song for Dua Lipa, you want to write a song for Lady Gaga, ones that are on the radio, as a songwriter, because publishing royalties are paid mostly on public performance. Yeah. Whereas like the royalties from songwriting on a stream of a song. So like you could have a song that has 100 million streams on Spotify.
Right.
But it's not played on the radio because there's tons of, you know, cultures that have big followings online, but sure, don't have a following on terrestrial radio, right?
Right, right.
Yeah, like most of it. Yeah. So those aren't as lucrative as a songwriter. The industry is slowly like changing and evolving, but it's certainly a time where it's difficult. There's not a whole bunch of sort of like everyday mid-level career songwriters, I think, the same way that there was maybe in the 90s. It's like, it's very competitive and it's very much about getting those top 20 hits on the radio.
You know, where you're hearing from the record reps part that, you know, hey, they're not as concerned about getting a song on radio because that's not exactly how we're going to move the product or move the artist. It's getting on playlists. It's getting on your Amazon list, your Spotify list. It's getting on those. But as a songwriter, you really want the radio because that's where it's going to pay.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So yeah, it's very interesting. And there's ways now as, you know, as a producer as well. So a lot of songwriters are also producers. You find other ways to, you know, accent the income to make it balance out. You can be a producer and collect more points on streams because you've worked on the master. So the master, you know, John, but for people listening, it's the actual recording. It's the actual tangible version of the song. It's like the song is the blueprint and then the master is the house in that certain subdivision. So if you help build that as a producer, then you're going to make a few royalties off of streaming that way. And again, it's kind of like, I mean, it keeps your motives pure as a songwriter, where we just have to work really hard from your heart on stuff you believe in. And, you know, you trust that if you do that, that every once in a while, one of those songs is going to make its way into the commercial mainstream and that will, you know, continue to pay your bills. It's also exciting though, as a songwriter, who's also like a bit of a singer myself, right? I'm like, nowadays with the internet, I'm inspired again. And with TikTok and this awesome distribution platform, I'm inspired again to like be an artist and like make music myself and build my niche following as Nathan Ferraro, the singer-songwriter. It's like, I just so believe in when new artists are coming to me now asking, how do I get on the radio? How do I do it? It's like, it's really about user data these days. And people, we can see who, I can't, but people, they can, the companies can see exactly. I mean, I can see it too. You just log in, you can see who's listening, when, and how viral something is. So we're coming back into a time when the only thing that makes sense again is to come from your heart, is to really, again, go to the most real place you can and put it on TikTok, and you'll find your clan. You don't have to be one of the 10 Grammy award winning or one of the 10 artists that the industry decides to put all their money behind.
Well, Nathan, we are so glad you're continuing to make stuff, and I'm just so overwhelmed. Thanks, happy for you every time I see your stuff go up the charts, and I'm hearing it on radio stations everywhere. I mean, it's just amazing. Thank you.
Thanks, John,
for your time with us here in Spotlight. Well, a big thank you to Nathan Ferraro. Such great candor, and learned quite a lot about the music business in just that one conversation. If you want to see the entire interview, Nathan was kind enough to sit down with us for almost about 40 minutes. We're going to be posting the entire interview online in the coming weeks. So keep up to date with our websites and our socials, and we'll post that out in the next little while. But definitely something to catch on to if you enjoyed that. Those bits, it's absolutely amazing. If you have one album to listen to this summer, if you have time to listen to only one full album, I recommend that you listen to The Greatest Short Story Never Told. That has been my pick for this summer, and it is it's very, very good. We finish up our conversations with Ontarians.
The name of the album is The Greatest Short Story Never Told. Is that a Craig Smith creation?
You know what, John? I'm gonna have to I'm gonna have to hand this one back to Frank. Frank is very good at what a lot of times throughout the pandemic, what's happened is we will get on a call, a FaceTime call, and they often last like 4 hours with multiple breaks in the middle, and all kinds of rich, fertile material happens during those calls, but not necessarily something we're planning to do, but it's like, hey, did you just say that sort of thing. So we both have just notes upon notes in our on our computers of just this random sort of stuff, which really is amazing for writing songs. So, and Frank, just to come back to your question, Frank came up with that title. And again, I thought right away it was pretty cool, but I wasn't sold on it. But like Frank, he has this way of kind of working this viral thing into you where you wake up and go, greatest short story never told. That's kind of cool. Yeah. All right.
The concept of the album in the days of the Spotify playlist or the iTunes playlist, many people think the album is dead. Yet you made a point of releasing an album. And having a chance to listen to it through, clearly you've made some decisions on track placement. You really looked at the album as a piece of art. Is that important to you guys? And is that something you're going to continue?
The first part, yes, it's important. Is that something we're going to continue? I mean, that's left to be seen, I think. it's a lot of work to make and put out an album, and there's a lot of good reasons to focus more on singles and things like that. And I think moving forward, that's something that we'll probably balance. I think probably the next thing that you hear from us will be more in the form of singles or EP or something like that. But we're not ruling out the album. I think when we started Ontarians, it was just let's make something together. And there wasn't really we didn't know that we were really going to become a band, to be honest. It was like let's work together and see what happens. And we got together for a week in February 2018, and by the end of that week, we had tracked six of the songs on that record, or at least like the basic the skeletons. And so, then it was like, okay, this is worth pursuing. And then there was a lot more work that happened after that. As it stands right now, I think we wanted, once that got rolling, it's like, okay, we're making an album. This is going to be an album that we enjoy. And now we're just writing songs and see what happens. But I'm excited to get out and tour this album and probably sprinkle in some new material from the next whatever. But in terms of albums, I don't think the album is dead. I like listening to albums, but I get, the business, it's a different framework right now that we're all working in. And so I think there's a balancing act that has to be done there between what you think is your best medium for creative expression. In this case, I think our introduction to the world as a group was best suited to a full album. Like, let's put out a full album. We've got a lot of different sounds and things that we want to say. And then moving forward, I think it's just going to be, those decisions will be made along the way.
The record is fantastic. I'm loving every single track of it. The two videos that you have out are outstanding. Even tracing back to some of your Lake Effect stuff, Frank, you were using video very cleverly, very interesting ways to present songs. Craig, I know that you shot some of your own videos on your iPhone.
Well, there was one for the song God and the Devil that was done by myself. But it's the easiest way to get things done these days. It's, a little ingenuity and stick to it, you'll get a video done.
Where did the concept come from, the video concept come from? Let's start with the song Time. Where did that come from, Frank?
Well, actually, Kim Zayak is the guy, another guy down in your area, who put the whole video together. But by the time we were working on this video, we were all apart and we couldn't get together. We were into the pandemic by now. And so we all shot our own footage just where we were.
I waited all night long to put a pen to page. When I'm feeling strong, it goes away.
It started off like we didn't know how it was going to turn out, and luckily we had Kim to kind of turn it into something that looks really good. So we all shot ourselves. I guess Kim shot Craig because they're in the same, basically the same place. But Chris, the drummer, just shot his own stuff on his phone, and Jay Styles was down in Texas, shot his own video, and then I did my own parts, and then sort of a bunch of time-lapse stuff just driving around the area up here. And we sent this sort of boatload of footage down to Kim, and he fashioned it into a video that makes sense.
And if you take the time. Yeah, that was actually kind of interesting how that came about, because Kim, because we were, helping run a bar called Crow Bar and Variety, which was a popular music venue here. And Kim and I really connected, and he's a veteran of Canadian music. He's a mover and shaker from back in the day. And we just, really hit it off. And I played him demos or the original mixes for this record that eventually came out. And he said, oh man, I really love that. I want to do video. And he's got a great history, great past of doing videos for much music, kinds of commercial spots, stuff like that. So it's always great when someone steps up and says they want to do a video. Take some of the pressure off us having to figure out what thematically we want to do. So
And you did a great job.
Video wise, for No Regrets is seemingly very simple, but it's really well shot. Where did that footage come from? And it fits so perfect into the song, and yet it doesn't really speak to the song, or does it?
That was Jay Styles, actually, the keyboard player in Ontarians. And we were basically like, we need another video. Do you have any ideas? And he was like, yeah, for sure. And so he was gonna shoot the video, and he had this whole idea with the bike and with Amy, his girlfriend, and everything. And then that was right when the big snowstorm hit down in Texas. And so then, you know, that passed, and I was just kind of like, okay, well, we're gonna have to come up with another idea for a video pretty quick. Then it sort of passed, and we were sort of like, hey, I'm glad you're okay. You still want to shoot that? You still want to do that video? And he was like, "Well, when is it due?" I was like, "We have about a week, you know." And so he got that done. He turned that around really fast. And yeah, he shot it all himself, edited it, and everything. And wow. Yeah.
I wish you guys the best on this album and the new music still to come. I cannot wait to see you guys perform live. I've seen you each perform live separately, but to hear this material done with you guys side by side, it's going to be amazing. Looking forward to it. And thank you for taking time to be here on Spotlight.
Appreciate it. Thanks for your time and for reaching out. It's great to talk with you. Thanks for the support.
Thank you very much. Thanks always for your support, guys. Means a lot, and for having us on the first show of the season, very much appreciated. We'll talk to you maybe next year after we've had some shows under our belt.
That would be great.
There you go. Whatever happens, happens.
Great to talk to Craig and Frank, and I'm so happy for the success of the Ontarians already.
Oh, and that album, I mean, you kind of got into asking about, you know, which you always do, the importance of the album, and it really is kind of like taking a road trip, you know? It just feels
through Ontario.
Right. Exactly.
It does feel right. Next up, a young lady that I get to see every weekday morning. She is amazing. I asked her if she would, on a monthly basis for us, check in on what's happening in the live music scene, where we can go and see shows. Now, it's a bit of a daunting task right now, but as the coming weeks, things are going to start to open up. So by next month, we'll have tons. But right now, let's check in with Melanie Case.
Music, the medicine of the mind, as they say. If you're like me, you've been highly anticipating the return of live music and just life in general. And as the restrictions continue to lift, many have been getting very creative in the way that they feature and promote our talent in our community. Theater Collingwood comes to top of mind in regards to creativity with their Portside Festival. This is where they have 24 live performances, 14 different talented artists, and 18 historic patios for you to be able to enjoy that makes up this one amazing festival. If you're looking for just some live music to be able to entertain you during the weekends, well, look no further than Lakeside Bar and Grill. They've got you covered Saturdays and Sundays. That's noon till 3 p.m. But maybe Cranberry Golf Resort at Station on the Green Bar and Grill is more your style. Well, you can prepare to be entertained with a variety of talent that happens on Sundays. Or if you don't get enough of him, Weekdays with me on Talk of the Town from Monday to Friday. And who am I talking than none other than John Eaton? He's going to be at Boston Pizza every Sunday with a special guest for Sunday Fun Day. So that starts at 3 p.m. for you to be able to enjoy, and it's always a blast. So if you are looking as well into the future of having some musicians at your establishment, especially if you're in Wasaga Beach, then you're going to want to check out the Open Patio Music Program that is taking place. So this is where basically you hire the talent and they pay the bill. So you can check out the town of Wasaga Beach. Well, their website is probably the best place for that information. But then looking into the future, in the, well, near future, when it comes to August 10th, mark your calendar, because that's when you're going to be able to take part in the Mountain Music Series. It is back, and it is going to be better than ever for you to be able to enjoy. So if you'd like to be featured, if you have some live music to let me know about, I'd love to hear it. You can just send me an email at general@thepeakfm.com. So we are, of course, so excited to see our musicians' friendly faces back on the stage. So get out, enjoy, and support our local music. Until next time, I'm Melanie Case. John, Tyler, back to you.
Thank you so much, Melanie. Great to hear things are opening up, and there's lots more opportunities to very soon see some live music. And hopefully we'll be at the Simcoe Street Theater very soon.
Hopefully. At the very least, I'm hoping you and I don't need to have these boxes, you know, separating us. Maybe we'll go with a plexiglass, something like that. But we'll see what August holds.
Something nice.
Something nice. We'll drape something over it and we'll gussy it up.
Very good. A big thank you to all of you for joining us for Live and Original Spotlight Season 2 premiere. It has been wonderful. Thank you to all of our guests. And don't forget, all of these episodes, well, this entire episode will also be available online. Plus, we're going to show you the unedited full segments of some of these great interviews that we've had.
Oh, yeah. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that gets trimmed, and it's not trimmed because the content is bad. It's just there's so much. Nathan, I feel like I kind of took like a 101 lecture. It filled my mind, so definitely something to look forward to.
If you have any questions or comments, make them right here in the Facebook comment section. You can also go to our social medias at the Peak FM or the town of Collingwood or Experience Collingwood.
That's it, and we are reading the comments. So Paul, John, Voracious, thank you folks for checking out the show, and Karen Cubitt, I know you're watching too, so definitely comment on our socials during the show with the new format we're going with. It allows us to kind of continue to connect, not just with the featured music fans, but you folks at home watching right now are music fans too. Otherwise, you wouldn't be watching. So thank you.
Second Monday of the month. We'll check in with you again next month for another Live and Original Spotlight.
Take care.
Times are coming, troubles are behind. done a little damage to myself. I've been unkind, made a few decisions I wish I could forget. Burned my share of bridges, but I still have no regrets. No regrets at all. Guilt became a burden to my mind, I will confess. Stumbled through the dark, all those nights I was a mess. I loved my share of lovers, but I never gave my best. Burned my share of bridges, but I still have. I could not manage. Well, that's the devil's share. That's the devil's share. Burn my share of bridges, but I still have.